And this short essay is titled A Brief History of Slavery and the Origins of American Policing. And it goes like this. The legacy of slavery and racism did not end after the Civil War. In fact, it can be argued that extreme violence against people of color became even worse with the rise of vigilante groups who resisted Reconstruction. Now, what people of color have to do with Reconstruction, I don't know, but let's carry on. Because vigilantes, by definition, have no external restraints, lynch mobs had a justified reputation for hanging minorities first and asking questions later. Because of its tradition of slavery, which rested on the racist rationalization that blacks were subhuman, America had a long, shameful history of mistreating people of color, long after the end of the Civil War. Now, can somebody please explain to me, in what Twilight Zone alternate reality did that history actually take place? Because that for sure is not American history. The terms people of color, minorities, and marginalized groups are by far the most weaponized terms used by politicians, academics, and mainstream media pundits when addressing issues that predominantly, if not exclusively, affect Black Americans. And for clarification, when I say Black Americans, I'm specifically speaking about the descendants of American slavery. Now, it's important for me to clarify that because what must be made clear is that when you're saying people of color, you're not talking about the descendants of American slavery. You're talking about immigrants and the children of immigrants who, by and large, showed up after the 1964 Civil Rights Bill was passed. Now, what a lot of people don't know is that almost immediately after the 1964 Civil Rights Bill was passed, it was followed up by the Immigration and Naturalization Act of 1965. Now, let's read up on that because this is very important. The Immigration and Naturalization Act of 1965, also known as the Hart-Celler Act, abolished an earlier quota system based on national origin and established a new immigration policy based on reuniting immigrant families and attracting skilled labor to the United States. Over the next four decades, the policies put in effect in 1965 would greatly change the demographic makeup of the American population as immigrants entering the United States under the new legislation came increasingly from countries in Asia, Africa, Latin America, as opposed to Europe. I'm going to read that last sentence again. Over the next four decades, the policies put into effect in 1965 would greatly change the demographic makeup of the American population, as immigrants entering the United States under the new legislation came increasingly from countries in Asia, Africa, and Latin America, as opposed to Europe. Now, you have to understand that the 1965 Immigration Bill was a direct response to the 1964 Civil Rights Bill. It was a form of retaliation towards the descendants of American slavery who essentially forced the nation to bend the knee and giving in to their demands of getting rid of the overtly racist Jim Crow laws. Understand, Europeans never had a problem getting into the U.S. I'm not saying it was easy for them to get in, but it wasn't a problem. Now, if you were a so-called person of color prior to 1965, it was borderline impossible to get into the U.S. The purpose of the immigration bill was to drown you out by having an influx of other groups coming in and then prioritizing them over you. And this practice is still very much in play till this day. To learn more about it, I would strongly recommend you watch my videos titled What a Biden-Harris Presidency Actually Mean for Black America, as well as White Skin, Black Mask, How Barack Obama Played Black Voters Just Like Joe Biden Will. In those two videos, I discuss this in great detail as to how these practices are still carrying on till this day. Now let's get into the term minority. Most people, meaning the everyday man and woman, use that term interchangeably with people of color, and it makes sense on the surface, but to use those terms interchangeably is incorrect because they do in fact mean two different things. What most people don't pick up on is that the term minority essentially means white women. Now follow me for a second. When you say people of color, you've said all that needs to be said, because the term people of color is not gender specific. It simply means non-white. Now, I know what some of you are going to say, and that's that, yeah, I hear you, Tony, but women should be classified as a minority because regardless of race, women have their own unique experiences of injustice simply for being a woman. And that also includes white women. Now, I could go on a tangent about how problematic this is, because essentially white women are able to play both sides of the fence. You see, by virtue of simply being white, you benefit from the system of racism, white supremacy, regardless of you being a woman, even though you may be limited in the things you can participate in. By the simple virtue of being white, you benefit from the system of racism, white supremacy by simply being the daughter of, or the mother of, or the wife of. So go into the past and discuss how women had it so hard and pretend as if white women and black women were on equal footing is wildly disingenuous. Despite the lack of rights, you can't compare a white woman from the 1950s to a black woman of the 1950s. That is wildly disingenuous. But for the sake of this video, I'm not going to go on and on about that. I'm simply going to fold it up, put it in my back pocket, and say, yes, you're right. Just for the sake of this video, though. Now, last on the list is marginalized groups. And the thing with marginalized groups is this. That categorization has nothing to do with gender or race. That is a categorization of people who are discriminated against because of A, their sexual preference, or B, their religion. Now, with all of this being said, please believe that I'm not the only one that has an understanding of what these classifications actually mean, because politicians do as well. They know exactly what these terms mean, as well as academics and political pundits as well. But it's particularly damning to black Americans when it comes to politicians, because they make it a point to insert these terms into what is supposed to be a black agenda. Take Joe Biden's, for instance. You know, lift every voice, the Biden plan for black America. Look how many times the term minority pops up in Joe Biden's black agenda. 19 times. Now look at how many times people of color pop up in his agenda. 5 times. Now look at how many times marginalized groups come up. 1 time. How is this a black agenda when everybody else gets to participate in it? You see, because I've seen this con game before. It was called affirmative action. And guess who was the number one beneficiaries of affirmative action? White women. Despite the fact that affirmative actions in its origins was supposed to be on some level a half-hearted attempt at reconciliation for the last 300 plus years of discrimination towards black Americans. That's what affirmative action was supposed to be originally. But when it turned to legislation that also included people of color, minorities, and marginalized groups, all of a sudden you find out that white women are the number one beneficiaries of this legislation. And as far as I'm concerned, it is not a coincidence that minorities pops up 19 times in Joe Biden's so-called black agenda. Minority meaning white women. Now, I know some of you are going to say, well, what about Trump's black agenda? What about the platinum plan? Don't worry, I'm going to talk about that this Friday when I go live. So that's on the way. But as far as Joe Biden's black agenda is concerned, this is completely garbage. But at the same time, it's not surprising, because this is what the Democratic Party does. Now, in closing, if the descendants of American slavery don't get this under control, your history will be completely wiped out in this country. And to prove that, I want to read a passage from this essay that was written by a very decorated college professor by the name of Victor E. Kapler. And this short essay is titled, A Brief History of Slavery and the Origins of American Policing. And it goes like this. The legacy of slavery and racism did not end after the Civil War. In fact, it can be argued that extreme violence against people of color became even worse with the rise of vigilante groups who resisted Reconstruction. Now, what people of color have to do with Reconstruction, I don't know, but let's carry on. Because vigilantes, by definition, have no external restraints, lynch mobs had a justified reputation for hanging minorities first and asking questions later. Because of its tradition of slavery, which rested on the racist rationalization that blacks were subhuman, America had a long, shameful history of mistreating people of color, long after the end of the Civil War. Now, can somebody please explain to me, in what Twilight Zone alternate reality did that history actually take place? Because that for sure is not American history. And mind you, once again, the man that wrote this, he's no schmuck. When I posted this on my Patreon page about 4 months ago, I quickly ran down his resume, and I'll read that for you right now. He is the author of numerous books on policing and criminology, including Forces of Deviance, Constructing Crime, Police and Society, Critical Issues in Police Civil Liability, Community Policing, and the Mythology of Crime and Criminal Justice. He is widely published in academic and scientific journals. Among them are Social Problems, Justice Quarterly, Journal of Criminal Justice, and Criminal Law Bulletin. Dr. Kapler has received numerous awards from both academic institutions and government agencies for his contributions to the study of crime and policing. This man is no schmuck. This is a well-respected man in society, across academia and government. And that's what he wrote concerning American history. A history in which the memory of you is but a blip. Your struggle and your lineage is virtually non-existent. And believe me when I tell you, he is not the only one in academia that writes like this. So if you don't make it clear to people that people of color, minorities, and marginalized groups does not mean descendants of American slavery, it's only a matter of time before you and your history will be completely wiped out and erased from this country. And with all that being said, that concludes this video. So make sure you hit that subscribe button as well as the bell notification next to the subscribe button so you can be notified whenever I release a new video. Also, make sure you text tdhiphop to number 33222. That's tdhiphop to number 33222. That way you'll get a direct text notification whenever I release a new video. But it also serves as a protection plan for myself in case YouTube ever decides to give this channel the axe. I'll be able to send you a direct link to where you can find me next. Also, all my social media links will be pinned in the comment section below as well as in the description. And last but certainly not least, for those of you who have been subscribed to this channel for quite some time now and have a love and appreciation for the work that I put in on this channel, the number one way you can show your support to me is through Patreon. For only $5 a month, that will help put me in position to be able to take TD Hip Hop Media off of YouTube. Remember, the goal is to grow independent of YouTube, not big on YouTube. Until the next video, peace.